once you can see the screen. You can see my screen? Perfect. Okay. Now, let's start with the remaining topics that we need to discuss with respect to the physical data model. In the last call, we discussed something about the base and aggregate factable. That was the last topic that we discussed. The next topic that we're going to discuss is with respect to the normalized or denormalized schema. A basic characteristic of any physical schema is its degree of normalization or denormalization. What do you mean by normalization? Normalization occurs when you have a schema that does not store data redundantly, that does not have any records which are getting repeated multiple times. So the normalization will make sure that it does not have any degree of data redundancy. Whereas the denormalization occurs when you have a schema design that store at least some data multiple times or redundantly. So the normalization where you do not have data redundancy, denormalization where you have some data redundancy. Either to go with the normalized schema, denormalized schema, that completely depends upon your database to database, your project to project, or you can say your environment to environment. Now, when you should normalize table, when you should denormalize table, that's something that we're going to understand over here. There are three types. Okay, this is just an example, the normalized and denormalized. Under one table, LU underscore item table on the left hand side, I have data specific to the item only. I have item ID and item description. I just have a subcategory as a reference column. So over here, there is very rare chance that my data will get duplicate because the data is only for the item. But if I look at the other table, again the LU underscore item, under which I have data for item, subcategory as well as category. For one category, I have multiple subcategories. So across all those records, my category will be repeated. For one subcategory, I will have multiple items. So across all those items, my subcategory will be repeated. And that's the reason it says it's a denormalized, where my data for some columns are getting repeated across rows. And you can see that there is a data redundancy. This is just an example, and we will try to understand more on it. There are three types of schemas that can exist in the warehouse. Completely normalized schema, moderately denormalized schema, and a completely denormalized schema. So let's try to understand one by one what are these schemas that we have. First, we're going to start with the completely normalized schema. A completely normalized schema is something where you will see no data redundancy. You will have all the tables specific to the corresponding attributes, and they have been organized as per the hierarchy. When you can say your schema is a completely normalized schema, from more technical perspective, I will say that every table will have the ID and description of their corresponding attribute. Along with that, it will just have the ID column of immediate parent table. So if you look over here, let's take an example, LU underscore item. I have the item ID and item description that is specific to the item attribute. Along with that, I have an ID column of only immediate parent table for doing the joining. That's it. When you have such kind of a schema, it says it's a completely normalized. You take any table over here, it will have the ID and description of that particular table. Along with that, it's going to have the ID column of only the immediate parent table. So let's say LU underscore subcategory. I have subcategory ID and subcategory description. Along with that, I just have the category ID of that is the column of the immediate ID column of the immediate parent table. Again, LU underscore category, I have category ID and category description, and under that I have a division ID that is the ID column of the immediate parent table. Take any child table, let's say LU underscore employee. I have employee ID and employee name, ID and description of those columns. Along with that, I just have ID column of immediate parent table. So they're very rare that my data, there would be any kind of a data redundancy, and that's the reason it says it's a completely normalized schema. What is the advantage over here? Of course, it's a completely normalized schema, so there I do not have to worry that there will be no data redundancy. Apart from that, as I'm saving my, I'm like, as I have a data individual to the corresponding dimensions, whenever there is any kind of data change, okay, where, you know, let's say I want to change any data for the division, my scope of impact analysis is very less because I have only specific table for the division. So I do not have to worry about the other tables because there is no impact on those tables. I just have one table to check, and this is a second table because it has a reference key on division ID. That's it. So my scope of impact is very less. There would be never a size constraint because all the I have different tables specific to only those attributes, and that's it. So even my table size will never run out. My table size will never be a constraint. But what would be the disadvantage for you? Let's say I'm trying to run a report to get the division data along with the dollar sales. When I try to run the report for higher level attributes, I really have to go through a series of joining all the tables and get the required data. So now let's say I'm trying to run a report for a division and the total dollar sales. So from here, first I will join this table based on item column. From here, I just have a reference of subcategory, so I will join on this table. From here, I will join on this table. And finally, from here, I will join with this table to get the division data. So I have to go through a series of 3 to 4 joinings just to get the required data. So whenever you are requesting the data for the higher level attributes, I really have to go through a series of joining all the tables and get the data. So of course, there might be impact in the performance. From the advantage perspective, yes, it's a normalized. Second, it's like, you know, the table space would not be a constraint. And even my scope of impact is very less if in case there is any data change. But from the disadvantage perspective is that whenever a user is requesting for the higher level data, I have to go through the series of joining all the tables, and based on that, my data will be retrieved. So it might see a performance lag over here. Okay, this is about the completely normalized schema. Second type of a schema that exists is moderately denormalized. Neither completely normalized, neither complete nor completely denormalized. Moderately denormalized. When we can say that it's a moderately denormalized, where it will show at least some degree of data redundancy. And from technical perspective, it says that all the child table will have the data for the corresponding attributes, that is the ID and the description of the corresponding attributes. Along with that, this time it will have ID columns of all the parent tables. In the previous, it was just for the immediate parent table, but this time it has the ID columns of all the parent table. So if you look at this example, let's start with the LU item. I have item ID and item description, and this time I have the ID columns of all the parent tables. Subcategory, category, and this is for division. So I have ID columns of all the parent table. Take any example, even let's say subcategory. I have subcategory ID and subcategory description, and I have category and division, that is the ID columns of both the parent tables. Take any other example. Let's say LU underscore employee. I have employee ID and employee name. Along with that, I have two columns over here, call center as well as region. That is the ID columns of both the parent table. So you say that whenever you have such kind of a schema, it says it's a moderately denormalized. Moderately denormalized because it will show at least some degree of data redundancy, because I for one division, I will have multiple categories. For one category, I have multiple subcategories. For one subcategory, I have multiple items. Of course, under subcategory, category, and division, I will see some records which are getting repeated. And that's the reason it says it's a moderately denormalized. What could be advantage over here? As compared to the previous schema, there will be a lesser number of joins. Take a same example. I'm trying to run a report for a division to get the total dollar sales. In this case, just because I have ID column of all the parent tables, from dollar sales, from the fact table, I will join this table on item ID. I have a reference of division over here. So I can directly skip all the intermediate tables and join with the higher level table to get the required data. I don't have to join the category table. I do not have to join the subcategory table. Because I have a reference of division ID, I can go and directly join with this table on division ID and get the division description. So over here, the advantage is that my table, I can get rid of some tables and the joining, and I might see a improved performance as compared to the previous schema. But what is the disadvantage over here? Now let's say my division data is getting updated and I want to do the impact analysis. Which whole table I have to do the analysis on? All the tables, because division ID is over here, division ID is over here, division ID is over here, division ID is over here. So basically, in my previous case, I just had to analyze two tables for the impact. But now over here, just because it has a reference in each and every table, I have to go and do the impact analysis on every table. So my scope of analysis to be done is more. Second, as I'm adding more columns in my tables, it's going to add a extra space to it. It's going to consume extra space for it. So these are the few advantages and disadvantages if you go with the moderately denormalized schema. The third and the last FO schema that can exist is completely denormalized schema. When I say completely denormalized schema, this schema will have the highest degree of data redundancy. And from the technical perspective, I can say this time the child lookup table will have all the ID column as well as description column of all the parent tables. So if you look at an example over here, I have value underscore item, which is showing me the data for item ID and item description. And this time it has the ID as well as the description columns of all the parent table. That is for subcategory, category, division, everyone. So not only the ID columns, it has even the description columns of all the parent table. Take any lookup table, child table. Let's say for subcategory, I have subcategory ID and subcategory description. Along with that, I have category ID, division, that is ID and description columns of all the parent tables. As because I'm adding more columns, both the columns, ID columns and description column, will have data duplicates, highest degree of data redundancy. But what could be the advantage over here? The advantage is that I have to join minimum number of tables. Let's take a same example this time. I'm trying to run a report for a division and a total dollar sales. From here, I will join directly to this table on item ID. And from here itself, I will get the division ID and division description. I do not have to join the upper tables to get the required data. I can get my entire reporting done based on only these four tables. Why? Because all the information are present in the lowest lookup tables. I do not have to go and create an extra join. I'll directly fetch from the lowest table itself. So my number of joins are going to get reduced and I might see a better performance. And that's the reason in the previous, like when we were discussing, there was one note added that you might denormalize the table for getting the better performance. It is not compulsory. Let me add a note over here. It is not compulsory that my denormalized schema will always give me the improved performance. That completely depends upon the environment and the tables that you are using, the data, that volume. So there are a few factors that you have to consider before deciding which schema you have to go with. We're going to discuss those factors, but just to add over here, that completely depends upon your project and environment or a database that you're using. This is the advantage. What is the disadvantage over here? Of course, it's going to consume a good amount of table space because everything I'm dumping into the tables, ID, description, everything. So from the future perspective, of course, it's going to add an overhead from the space constraint. Same thing, even if I do the impact analysis, if there is any change, I have to scan almost all the tables to do my impact analysis because there is a reference of that column everywhere in the lookup table. So of course, my scope of impact analysis is more over here. I'm going to take a pause over here. Any question with respect to normalized schema or denormalized schema? I'm going to discuss further which schema falls under a snowflake schema or a star schema. But before we go ahead and discuss on that, any question over here? No? Perfect. Okay. So now, let me get rid of this. Okay, so as I said, for the completely denormalized schema, I can just consider these three tables. I can get rid of all these tables. So something my schema will look like this. I have one fact table surrounded by the lowest lookup table. These are all aggregated lookup tables, right? Because I'm using all the information is present in my lowest lookup tables. All have been aggregated over here. So it makes me feel like my one fact table is surrounded by multiple dimension tables, just like as a star structure. And such kind of a schema is a star schema. You generally first ask, you know, when we start with the data warehousing concepts, everyone starts with what is star schema and what is snowflake schema. That's not the correct way. First, there is a concept called as normalization or denormalization. And when you have a completely denormalized schema, you can have the fact table surrounded by multiple lookup tables. It makes you feel like it's a star, and that's the reason it says it's a star schema. A star schema is a completely denormalized schema. Then what is a snowflake schema? A snowflake schema is a completely normalized schema. Whenever you design a snowflake schema, it will have something as a ladder-like structure, and this is the snowflake schema where every data, the corresponding data will be under the corresponding lookup table. So you really have to go through the chain of all the tables to find the required set of data. And accordingly, it's going to be displayed in the output. So yes, that depends upon what kind of a schema design you have to go. But to make you understand over here, completely normalized schema is equivalent to your snowflake schema, and a completely denormalized is a star schema. So in general, we have two types of schemas, like something called a star schema and snowflake schema. But in actual, we have a three types of schema, which is completely normalized, moderately denormalized, or completely denormalized schema. Okay. Apart from this, the last thing that we need to discuss from the data warehouse schema perspective are the factors that you have to consider while creating a data warehouse schema. So the optimal schema design depends upon the factors specific to your project and the database environment. So that completely depends upon the project to project and the environment, the database environment that you're using. The basic structure of your data warehouse is often a combination. Some majority of the time, I would say that we prefer to go with a combination of Starflake and Star and the Snowflake schema. There are a few factors that you have to consider while designing a data warehouse schema. First and very important, user reporting requirement. It always has to be in line with your user reporting requirement. You're going to consider all the objects and all the tables, and you have to make sure that that can fulfill the reporting requirement. Second is the query performance. I have to get my schema designed in such a way that I get a decent performance. I get a decent report performance. I can't ask my users to wait for like 30 minutes to get a simple set of data. So you have to make sure all the tables and the linkages have been correctly defined to get a good performance. Third is the data volume and the database maintenance. A data volume is something that you need to consider, because this is not a one-time implementation, right? Let's say I will go with the star schema where I will dump everything under one table. But what if you're targeting a huge volume of data? Even under that, my data retrieval will be slow, right? Even I'm going with the denormalized schema, even if I'm going with the denormalized schema, but in my lowest lookup tables, I'm trying to get millions and millions of records. Of course, it has to scan the entire table and fetch the required data. Even in that case, my performance will be bad. Instead of that, I could have easily went with the Snowflake schema. So that depends which schema you have to go with. The one factor also decide is the data volume. And the last is the database maintenance. This is not one-time implementation, as I say. You even have to look from the maintenance perspective. I will not go ahead and create just for creating it. Like after 6 months, I understand it's facing the performance issue, it is facing the space constraints. So of course, you have to even consider from the future maintenance perspective. So these are the factors that you really have to consider while designing the data warehouse schema. user reporting requirement, query performance, data volume, and database maintenance. This is all that we have from the physical data model concepts. Any question over here? No? Perfect. So we saw the logical data modeling concepts, we even saw the physical data modeling concepts. Now what we're gonna do is we'll go to the MicroStrategy once again. No, Chandan, I cannot hear you. Okay, all right. Now, perfect. Okay, so now the next thing that we're going to do is we already discussed about the physical model and the logical modeling concepts. Now let's try to go ahead and create the facts in MicroStrategy. The first type of a schema objects that we're gonna see how to create it are the facts. So now from now we're gonna start discussing on the architect development in MicroStrategy. We're gonna see how to create the schema objects, the required schema objects in our environment. The first topic that we're going to discuss from the development or the architect perspective are the facts. We already know what are facts, right? The facts are the measures, the facts are the numerical columns, and on top of that, we're going to perform the aggregation. So now, let me just first show you the sample data. I'll go to the warehouse catalog. We have already imported the required tables, right? So, okay, I want to get rid of all this prefix. I don't want to use all this prefix. Okay, this looks good. Now let me take one example. Let's say this table. I'm going to show you sample data. And if you look under this table, I have certain measures columns like total dollar sales, unit sales, total cost, gross dollar sales. These are all facts, right? Because these are all numerical columns. These are all measures that signifies the performance of my organization. And of course on this I'm going to perform some aggregation like sum of dollar sales, sum of unit sales, and so on. So for this are the columns which I'm going to identify to be created as the fact. So let's go ahead and start creating the facts on this column. So I'm going to close this. I'll come back to the MicroStrategy project, and under fact folder I'm going to say create new fact. I'm going to say create new fact. The first thing that you have to do is you have to select the table where the column resides, and then you have to select the column on which you want to create your fact. So I'm going to select the same table, that is city underscore month sales, and the first fact that we are trying to create is the total dollar sales. So I'm going to drag and drop this column under the expression, and you can see we are trying to create a new fact using an expression called TOT underscore dollar underscore sales. So this is the column to which my fact will be mapped. There are two ways you can map the tables: automatic mapping, manual mapping. Let's first understand manual mapping. If I go with the manual mapping, what MicroStrategy does is MicroStrategy is going to scan all the tables. As of now, while creating the facts, I have just selected one table, that is city underscore month underscore SLS. There would be other tables as well which has the same column called TOT underscore dollar underscore sales. So I have to make sure that even those tables are getting are to be mapped with this particular fact. So what MicroStrategy does is when I say the manual mapping, it will scan all the tables which has a column called TOT underscore dollar underscore sales, but it will not map it automatically. It will ask us like, okay, now you decide, these are the tables which are available, but now you decide which all table needs to get mapped to. If I say okay over here, MicroStrategy came up with like, okay, these are the tables which has a column called TOT underscore dollar underscore sales, but none of the tables have been mapped over here. So I'm going to click on few of the tables and I can see, okay, these are the tables to which I want to get my fact mapped to. And that is the reason it says it's a manual mapping, where you are manually have to select the tables to which it has to get mapped. After a few months, if there is new table getting added into your MicroStrategy project, and even that table has the total underscore dollar underscore sales column, you have to map that table manually over here. But what if I go with the automatic mapping? So I'm going to close this. I'm going to create new fact over here again. Same thing. We'll create on total dollar sales. And I will go with the automatic mapping. And if I say OK, and this time you can see again the fact has been created, but all the tables are been mapped automatically. So it says, okay, these are the tables which has the same column, that is total dollar sales. But yes, as we have went with the automatic mapping, all the tables have been mapped automatically. So even in future, when new table is added, and if in case it has a column TOT underscore dollar underscore sales, even that column will be mapped over here. Now, the question over here is that why do we need mapping? We need mapping because from which table you're going to fetch the data? How MicroStrategy is going to understand from which table, which all tables I can fetch the required data? Column has been mapped. I understand TOT underscore dollar underscore sales is the column that I have to map. I have to use for the data extract. MicroStrategy should also understand from which table I need to fetch the data, and that's the reason you need a mapping. So mapping is like, okay, so mapping with the table. So MicroStrategy understand either of this table I have to use to extract the data for total dollar sales. Does it make sense now? Perfect. Chandan, is it good? Okay, you use the column from sales table, right? I use the column from city underscore MNTH underscore sales table, and that's the reason MicroStrategy scans. See, at one point of when I create the expression, I can select only one table, and that's the reason MicroStrategy says, okay, there are other tables as well which has the same column name, and do you want to get it mapped to those table as well? So if I do a reporting, let's say on CT month and the sales, it will automatically pick up this table. If I place some other attributes, let's say subcategory, it will automatically pick up from this corresponding table. So by mapping, by having this fact mapped to multiple tables, MicroStrategy can get the optimal SQL generated. So when you run the report, depending upon the other attributes or the metrics you use in the report, MicroStrategy will generate the optimized SQL. It will make sure that it fetches from the correct table, and accordingly my data will be fetched. Is this clear now, Chandan? Yes, of course, you should know this beforehand to which all tables you want to get it mapped, and that's where your logical modeling and fuzzy model is going to come into a picture. From logical model, I understand I have to create a fact which is on total dollar sales, but from physical model, I will understand, okay, these are all tables to which it has to get it mapped to. Okay, perfect. Now, when you have, so we have created this expression, we have mapped to all this table, and I can simply say save and close. Just remember, it's a schema object, so you have to make sure you update the schema. What is the fact that we have created over here? It is the homogeneous fact with simple expression. What do you mean by homogeneous fact? Homogeneous facts are the facts which has the same column name across all the tables. So if you look over here, I'm using only one expression, which is TOT underscore dollar underscore sales, and it has the same column name across all the tables. So whenever in my project I want to see the revenue information, total dollar sales information, I can go to any table, any of this table, and in every table I have a same consistent column name. So when you do not have to resolve any kind of a naming discrepancy, those attributes, facts are called as homogeneous facts. Homogeneous facts are the facts which has the same column name across all the tables. And why simple expression? Because it is just mapped to a single column, which is TOT underscore dollar underscore sales. I'm not using any kind of an arithmetic operation or doing some kind of a calculation over here. It is just mapped to a single column. So this is the homogeneous fact with a simple expression. Now, let's say a new table got added into my project. And even in that table, I have the revenue information. But that column is not been indicated by TOT underscore dollar underscore sales, and that's the reason that table did not get mapped over here. But I want to make sure that this fact can fetch the data from that table as well, but just it had a different column. One way I can go back to the database guys and say, okay, this is the table. You make sure that the column name is renamed to TOT underscore dollar underscore sales so that I can map it in my fact. Or else you have to manually add that column. You have to resolve the naming discrepancy of that column at a fact object level itself. And how you can do it? It's very simple. You can just create one more expression. You will click on new over here. You will select that particular table which has a different column name but showing the same data. So I'll go to the corresponding table, which is order underscore fact, and the column that I have to use is order underscore amount. Even order underscore amount shows me the revenue data, but just because the column name is order underscore amount, that table did not got mapped over here. So I'm going to create new expression. I'm saying order amount, and I will say okay. That's it. So my same fact is mapped to all the required columns. TOT underscore dollar underscore sales coming from all these tables. Order underscore amount mapped to this particular table. So what we have done over here, we have resolved the naming discrepancy. So when I use this particular metric, I mean, of course, I have to create a metric on fact, right? And when I use this in the report, MicroStrategy is very intelligent enough to fetch the required data from the corresponding table and the column. So if I'm trying to pull some information, I'm trying to pull some objects which is mapped to the order underscore amount, order underscore fact table, it will automatically come and fetch the order underscore amount for the revenue metric. Or else it will go and fetch from TOT underscore dollar underscore sales. So that is not compulsory that my column name will be consistent in all the tables in my project. Not necessary. That depends, right? And if in case you have a naming discrepancy, you can definitely even resolve it at a MicroStrategy level. So over here we saw we had a different column name, but we still got it mapped to the same fact. And when you resolve such kind of a naming discrepancy and you create such kind of a facts, those are called as heterogeneous facts. Heterogeneous facts are the facts where you have a naming discrepancy and you resolve it at a fact level. And I can simply now go ahead and save my fact. Again, even under this heterogeneous facts, the expression that we are using is the simple expression. Why simple expression? Because it is just mapped to the single column. Either it's order underscore amount or it is TOT underscore dollar underscore sales. In both the case, it is mapped to a single column. I will take a pause over here. Any question with respect to homogeneous, heterogeneous facts or simple expression? No? Perfect. Now, I'm going to close this. This fact looks good. I'm going to save this and I'm going to close it. And I'm going to update the schema. Let me try to create one more fact. I'm going to say create new fact. And this time, we're going to create on gross revenue. I have something called as gross dollar sales, which indicates gross revenue. So I'm going to click on gross dollar sales, automatic mapping. I will say OK. All the tables got mapped. It is mapped to gross dollar sales. This looks good. I have one more table which does not shows me gross dollar sales directly. But under the same table, I have two columns. And if I multiply that two columns, it will definitely give me gross dollar sales, the value equivalent to gross revenue. So now I have to go and first map that table. and I have to use both the tables. I have to multiply that to make sure it gives me the gross revenue. So as of now, the first expression that we have used is gross underscore dollar underscore sales mapped to the corresponding table. And now I'm going to again click on new. I'll go to that corresponding table, which is order underscore detail table. And under that, if I multiply quantity sold and unit price, so the quantity sold and unit price is equal to the gross revenue, and I have to make sure the new expression that I create has to be multiplication of two columns. So what I have to do is I will place first quantity sold, I'll click on multiply by, and I'm going to say unit price. Valid expression? Yes. Again, I will go with the automatic mapping, but the expression, if you look over here, it's doing multiplication of two columns. And if I say okay, so if you look over here, two expressions have been used, gross dollar sales and quantity sold multiplied by unit price. So what is the expression that we are using? This is the derived expression. Why derived expression? Because we are performing some arithmetic operation under the expression itself, so that whenever you create a metric and you place in the report, it's going to do the summation of entire this arithmetic calculation, which is quantity sold multiplied by unit price. So whenever this gross revenue was not directly present as a column in the table, right? We multiply two columns to get the gross revenue, and as it is, and it says you're deriving altogether at a fact level. So this is the derived expression. So there are a few things that you have to know about the facts: homogeneous and heterogeneous facts, and from the expression, simple expression or derived expression. And once I save this fact, again, either it's going to fetch the data from the gross underscore dollar underscore sales, or it will multiply the two columns and fetch the data for me. I can just simply save and close this. I can just simply go ahead and save this fact, and my data will be pulled by MicroStrategy accordingly. Is this clear with respect to the homogeneous facts, heterogeneous facts? Under each fact, it could be simple expression or derived expression. Any question over here? No? Perfect. So over here, what we have seen is that we first saw what is the normalization, denormalization. We saw the factors that you have to consider. We saw what is the star schema and the snowflake schema. We even started with the MicroStrategy architect, where the first topic that we discussed were the facts. Under the facts, we saw how we can create the facts via fact editor. When I say right click, I say create new fact, I selected the tables, I selected the columns on which I want to define my fact. And we saw what are homogeneous, heterogeneous facts. We saw simple expression and derived expression. There is one more way that you can create your facts. Now let's say you started working on a project, and you just started working from scratch. You do not have any objects created, anything, nothing has been present, okay? And you want to create the facts in bulk. Even that is possible. As of now, via this method I can create only one fact at a time, right? I will say create new fact. So only one fact can be created at this point of time. This is via fact editor. There is something called as fact creation wizard, which will allow me to create facts in bulk. I can even create around 100 facts just by following a few simple steps. But that is something that we will see it tomorrow. Tomorrow we're going to discuss how to create the facts in bulk. And thereafter, we will start with the attribute topic. But for today, we will just stop over here. Tomorrow, we're going to meet up at the same time, and we will continue from there. Yes, Chandan, please go ahead. Yes, Chandan, I can wait till you reconnect. Chandan has a few questions, so he's going to reconnect. And let's see.
Hello.
Yeah, Chandan.
Yeah. Okay. Could you show your desktop, that Microstrategy desktop? Okay. So where can I find the data sources? I mean, okay, this is a different question. Where can I find the data sources of Microstrategy after I get it installed?
Data sources of
Is
what?
it a,
I didn't get it. When you say
the
data,
access databases? Sorry, access database.
see your project. Okay, it's a simple thing. You would have created the database instance, right? There would be some database instance to which your project is getting mapped. So I'll go to the
I
data.
still do not. I didn't go till there because I have to find those data. You created a folder, right, in
One second,
your
I'm showing
ma
that only. I'm showing that only. Just give me a minute.
okay.
Okay. This project is point. I'm going the other way around. This project is pointing to a database instance. So I will go to the database instance. I know this is pointing to this particular my database instance. I will modify this. I will modify. I'll see to which ODBC it is pointing to. I'll click on modify. It is pointing to 8_DWH. This is my ODBC that I have, and it is pointing to 8_DWH. Now I will go to ODBC. I'll go to the ODBC over here, and if I go and see the 8_DWH, it is under my D drive. This location could be different. That depends where exactly you have saved your databases. So if in case you want your MicroStrategy where your database has been pointing to, you configure, you go to the first database instance, first check to is pointing to which ODBC. From ODBC, you check from which particular location it is getting fetched to. And if I click on select, I can easily see it's under E, that I have some database folder, and from there it is picking up the which file, it is picking up the sample underscore data file. So you can confirm it from here.
And some database instances, they are pointing to two or three, in the default ones in MicroStrategy Analytics module, in the
It
database
is your
instances, they are
project.
like.
It is your project which is pointing to multiple database instances. It means that, see, by default, whatever the default one you see, it's gonna be used every time to fetch the required data. But there could be your case when you want to source your data from multiple instances. Now, let's say your project is you have your live project. Forget about the this tutorial project. You're working in a project on a client side, and I have some data to pull from my primary database, which is Oracle. I also want some data to be pulled from Teradata. There is some data that I want to pull it from that particular database as well. So you can create two database instances and you can map it under the same project. But the default one is something which is going to be used by default. So yes, you have to make sure that you under the warehouse catalog, you select the second database instance which is pointing to Teradata. You import those tables, you create the object from it, and when you use those objects in the report, it will automatically go to the Teradata database and fetch the data from there. It is not that your project can point to only one database, it can even point to multiple databases.
I think this is the location where I saw where like three or four database instances are checked in the default projects of MicroStrategy Analytics. So you're saying when that is checked, I can actually get all the tables from all those instances?
Yes, definitely, and you can do a reporting
Okay.
on that as well. But that it's very rare where you want to source it, but this is an option which is available. Okay, so it's not that MicroStrategy is restricting something. You decide your environment, you decide how you want to build it, on which you want to do the reporting, and accordingly you can configure your environment.
Okay, the default ones, the projects which are there, like in the HR reporting, I guess, for MicroStrategy, those are all read-only. I can't edit them.
The tables.
No. If you close this, the projects, like how it says, first project, when I installed MicroStrategy, I got something called HR
You can modify.
project.
No, you can modify. Just make sure that you're not under a read-only mode. There is a one something called as read-only mode. Just disable that. You can modify everything.
Oh, okay.
It's
So
a
I can go to
yes.
schema and say where I
Anything,
check in, because
anything.
that was, and here did we create this in 2-tier and 3-tier, did we create any project there, or did we start
We
creating
create
project directly in
We created first project, right? If you remember in the first class itself when we were configuring all this metadata projects, so at that point of time only we created the first project, right?
You deleted the default ones and you created this, right?
I'm like, I didn't start with the tutorial project. I started with a fresh configuration.
Yeah, I have to go back to the video. It's a bit confusing.
No problem.
I'll ask you and clear it out before starting something.
No problem.
Right, I think that's it.
All right, sure. So let's stop over here for today. We'll meet up tomorrow at the same time and we'll continue with the other topics. All right. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.